Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the D.L. Parsons Theater for an evening of celebration and inspiration. I am Carol Dodge, and I'm the mayor of this beautiful city. I have one housekeeping ask tonight, and that's that you would ensure that your cell phones are turned off. And before I begin the program, I have quite a few Northglenn notables to mention in the audience tonight. And I am totally blinded, so I know that you're all out there, and if I can't see you, I'm sorry. I will start with our current city council members. We have, in Ward 1, Meredith Lighty and Jordan Sowers. Would you like to stand when I say your names? You can stand, because then I could see where you are, actually. In Ward 2, we have Becky Brown and former mayor and present city council member Joyce Downing. From Ward 3, we have Marcy Whitman and Julie Duran Mullica. And in Ward 4, we have Mayor Pro Tem Antonio Escobel and Jenny Wilford. So that's our present council. In the audience, we have former mayors for the city of Northglenn, Odell Berry. Where is Odell? I can't see him. Hi, Odell. I meant to say hello at the reception, but I didn't get a chance. And we also have former Mayor Kathy Novak. We have current representative from HD 34, Kyle Mullica. Former State Senator Beth Humanick. We have NURA Commissioner Chris DeMay. And Northglenn High School Principal Sherry Blunt. Thank you. Having lived in Northglenn for 20 years and having owned and operated a business for over 25 years in the city of Northglenn, I've seen the city grow and change, but always keep to our roots as the most perfectly planned community in America, as a designation given to Northglenn by Life magazine in the early 60s. We are celebrating our 50th anniversary this year in 2019. We are embracing the past, the present, and the future. And tonight's event helps highlight one of our homegrown heroes, Lieutenant General Laura Richardson. Northglenn is, at its heart, a community that works together as individuals, businesses, schools, community organizations, and community leaders to build a better future for all. The Lieutenant General's career serves as a guide for the young women and men serving in the junior ROTC today. We are fortunate in Northglenn to have 14 schools in the city, all part of Adams 12 five-star schools, which reminds me, I know Superintendent Chris Godowski is out there, and I forgot to say him. He's important. Sorry, Chris. To kick off the evening, we will share a short video of our Northglenn students participating in the Junior ROTC program, Building Leadership and Pride and Family. History begins now.
I come from a really long line of military family. My dad was in the Navy. His dad were all in the Navy. And I've been in a flight school for a while, training to be a pilot, and I figured military should be my route.
Thank you.
originally I wanted to join because I wanted to be in the military, in the Marines. And so I thought being ROTC would like show me like the path or how they'd be training, you know.
Every time I wake up, I know I'm coming in to do some push-ups and some sit-ups and some planks, and we're always usually learning something every day.
It's so awesome when you see everybody get in step and they do the drill perfectly. It's amazing. I watch them and I'm like, I wish I got that on video. I wish I could be in there doing it with them, but seeing it is awesome.
It's just fun for me. Like, I just find it really interesting the way how we're all in uniform, and it just makes me feel like I'm actually in the group.
I've always wanted to do something with the service, and what I want to do, I feel like it would be a better route to go ROTC than enlisting.
Going into the military is a little scary, but I really want to be a pilot and join the Air Force and do all that, go into ROTC in college, and it's really life-changing.
The girls could do anything they want to do. If they want to join the military, I say go for it.
The feeling of like all of us in uniform, especially on Tuesdays, all being together, it's a good feeling.
While I have had the honor and the privilege to meet Lieutenant General Laura Richardson tonight, and she's so wonderful and down to earth, I am giving the honor of introducing our keynote speaker to former City Council member and community leader Rosie Garner, who currently serves as chairpersons for both our Northglenn Arts and Humanities Foundation and our Northglenn Urban Renewal Commission. God, I said that wrong. Northglenn Urban Renewal. Authority. What is my problem tonight? All right, authority. That was a great intro, huh, Rosie? Okay, so without any further ado here, Rosie has known Laura since she was 11 years old. She'll be a great person to give you some entertaining facts. So come on out.
Oh, my. Welcome, everybody. This is really quite the night. I'm welcoming you because tonight we're going to pay tribute to our Northglenn native, Laura Strickland, also known as Lieutenant General Laura Richardson. Laura actually grew up in Northglenn. She was born in Kansas City, I believe. Is that right, Sue? Sue, I can't see you. But she grew up in Northglenn, so she belongs to us. Before I start, I would like to introduce the family. Laura's parents are in the front row, Dr. Darwin Strickland and Sue Strickland. Can you please stand up? And with her is Laura's sister, Elaine. Can you stand up, Elaine? I want to mention that not here tonight are a couple of other siblings, Janice and Darwin. And Janice is not able to be here tonight, but I think there's something interesting that you should know about her other siblings, and that is that they both were in Iraq when Laura was in Iraq. So all three of them were deployed and in active duty during the Iraq War. So I think that's worth a notice of this family. (Clears throat) I just want to say that those who planned this little event tonight, a very large event actually, wanted me to give a perspective of Laura's early years. And I'm sure there are a lot of you out there who remember her as a young girl, but I remember her with the Northglenn Dolphin swim team, the famous Northglenn Dolphin swim team. They were quite the dynasty for many years in this city and swam at the Natatorium, which is now filled in. I was just there last week. It's kind of creepy, actually, to be. It's because now it has a floor and the STEM school is there. So I looked up and the ceiling is still the same, so that kind of made me feel a little more comfortable. But she, like I said, was born in Kansas City. I just want to say I have a very large font here so I don't have to wear my glasses. she attended Northglenn High School and she graduated in 1982. Can I have a slide, please? This is not her graduating. This is Laura. This is from my family album. Laura probably at, what do you think, 8, 9, something like that. And I think that's Peggy Dollahan.
It is.
And maybe Terry Noah. She spent a great deal of her time as a young girl swimming, practicing swimming, swimming, practicing swimming, competing, swimming, practicing. In the meantime, she learned to fly and got her pilot's license at age 16. So there was kind of the beginning of, I think, a long career in the air, so to speak. I just knew Laura as a standout, as a swimmer. She was a great swimmer. She was a great role model to the other swimmers on the team. And she always seemed so focused. I just wish my daughter, Angie, who also swam with her, had the focus and the drive and the determination that she did. It really was something to watch. The Dolphins were a rather large competitive swim team in the 70s and 80s. And their coach was initially Jim Kitamura, who now lives in Hawaii and still communicates with them on a Facebook page, the Northglenn Dolphin Swim Team Facebook page, and Ken Abuna, who's here tonight. And I don't see you, Ken, but I know you're here.
There he is.
I was the president of the Booster Club, which was basically the parents, along with Nancy Harada. And we kind of did a lot of, we took care of the team. We bought their swimsuits and their warm-ups, and but the most important thing we did was we ran the Northglenn Open, which was an annual three-day swim meet at the Natatorium. Can I see a next slide, please? This is just three of the covers of the program. It was like 500 kids swimming over 3 days, and that's three covers from the programs for those 3 years. Next slide. This was the Dolphins. Look how cute they are. That's Laura on the top row, from second from the, I guess it would be your left. They just were a great bunch of kids, and they worked hard and were disciplined. And I think if you were to look at where these young kids are today, it'd probably be pretty impressive, because they've all, not all I'm sure, but many of them have done very well for themselves. Laura actually swam both high school and Dolphins, and I have the next slide. This is an early Northglenn High School team picture from like 1979, and Laura's on top there with the circle. She was a four-time All-American, honorable mention, went in high school, and a state record holder. Next slide. This is This is a what we like to remember as a phenomenal 400 relay, girls relay team. From the left is Kim Holmes, my daughter Angie, Laura, of course. Laura, you've not seen this, I know. And Valerie Fontaine on the right. They were quite the swimmers, and their record is still up in the small gym at the current Northglenn High School, so they were pretty amazing. Next slide. This was kind of a celebration after. Some, probably this relay team, that's Laura and my daughter, with cake all over their face, so they were celebrating for sure. Northglenn High School came in second in the state swimming championships during Laura's senior year. And as I said, many of her teammates are here tonight. I think this is kind of sound kind of weird, but I really remember Laura Strickland from the rear. Laura had shoulders that you just would not believe. They were muscular and wide, and she was a butterflyer and a breaststroker, so that made for some pretty amazing shoulders. It was something that sticks in my mind, as many of us, I'm sure. From high school, graduating in 1982, like I said, she went to Regis University, where she swam NCAA, and she there gained 4 All-American designations while at Regis. Can I have the next slide? That's actually her senior year. Next. This is at Regis, and it's a newspaper article about her swimming career at Regis. And the next slide, please. That's Laura there on the right in third place, hate to say that, but in NCAA swimming. From Regis, she went to Metro because I think she had a calling to fly once again and joined ROTC program there. I have a quote from one of her sergeant majors at Metro. She was without question one of the top ROTC cadets in all the Colorado colleges. That was said by Sergeant Major Mike Padilla of the ROTC unit at Metro. Laura wanted an aviation career, and ultimately she certainly got it, plus so much more. When she graduated from Metro, she received her commission as an aviation officer and started training to be a helicopter pilot. It's pretty much an upward career after that, and that's culminating, at least so far, as a 3-star general. Laura, I think you finally outdid Rhonda Rape. That's an inside one for her. I'm going to ask the swimmers in the audience to give Laura a shout out in the famous words, you guys ready, of Dr. Strickland used at swim meets. I remember it clearly. He would stand on the upper bleachers and yell out, what? Go, Laura Jane! Go, Laura Jane! Go, Laura Jane! And with that special greeting from her fellow swimmers, I'd like to introduce our guest speaker this evening. She's the acting commanding general and deputy commanding general for the U.S. Army Forces Command, overseeing, this is amazing, 776,000 active and reserve troops, along with over 90,000 civilians. And she belongs to us. Lieutenant General Laura Richardson.
My goodness. Oh my goodness, it is so bright. It's hard to see. Maybe that's good. Well, the Rosie, that was very nice. And Mayor Dodge, thank you so much. It is certainly my honor to be here. But if I could, that video of the ROTC, if I could, before I start my remarks, just I would like to have Lieutenant Colonel John Durnford, and I don't know if Master Sergeant Temple is here, along with the cadets, but John, if you could stand up first. Okay, but that is, he is the professor of the military science there for the ROTC and the junior ROTC, and that, what an incredible program. And John had invited me to speak at the military ball Saturday night, so I flew in on Saturday and I was able to attend that with all of the cadets. And so now John is my sister's classmate, Elaine. They graduated the same time. I graduated with his older brother from Northglenn, Joe, but four brothers, all from Northglenn High School. So let's have the cadets stand up as well, and let's give them a round of applause. Thank you so much. Well, good evening, Northglenn. Woohoo! Oh, it is really good to be back here in my hometown, and it seems just like yesterday, I was having to stay after school for Mr. Lemieux's biochemistry class at Northglenn High School to finish my project that was late. So, but I am so honored to be a part of Northglenn's 50th anniversary and Women's History Month, and to return to my hometown and be able to speak to all of you. Thank you to the city of Northglenn, and I'm just gonna recognize some of the same people that the mayor did, but it's really important that I do that. But Senator Beth Humenick, she's here tonight. Thank you for being here. Mayor Odell Berry and Kathy Novak, thank you both for coming. City Manager Heather Geyer, that's a tough job. I know all about that. And the esteemed eight city council members that are here as well. President of the school board, Kathy Plomer, and the elected board officials, also a very tough job. And our very good friend, the Adams 12 Schools Superintendent, Chris Skidowski. And it's wonderful to see so many familiar faces too. So we have Sherry Blunt here as well. Chris DeMay was my classmate too. Rosie Garner, Master of Ceremonies, and her phenomenal 36-year career in the Veterans Administration. I mean, there are so many people that are just serve our community and serve our nation. And then also, of course, my swim coach, Ken Abuna, and also my math teacher. Don't take math over. I think I had math during like the lunch period, and I would always like catch myself doing a little 5-minute like cat nap right during that, which was not good. That wasn't good to do that in the math class. But anyway, it's so good to have you here. Thank you for coming. But my high school classmates that are here as well, Valerie Fontaine, Judy Dollahan, just so many wonderful folks to see. And you guys are really special. So thank you so much for being here. I feel extremely lucky to have grown up in such a wonderful place as Northglenn, Colorado. The tremendous opportunities that are here in Northglenn and in the state of Colorado are just amazing. Not just for recreation and culture, but for what really sets our city of Northglenn apart from other metropolitan and residential areas in Colorado, and that is our people. Northglenn is about the people, a safe and secure city, high quality schools, and a close-knit caring community who have committed themselves to the well-being of our neighborhoods and our children. My roots are here in Northglenn, and while I have lived in so many different places from being in the military, I have found numerous opportunities to come back home. My time growing up in Northglenn was really defined by my community, which was sports. And as many of you know, I am the oldest of four kids, and I grew up as an athlete in my household. Actually, all of us kids did. My sisters and brother participated in swimming and track, and for me as the oldest, I was a competitive swimmer from 5 years old to 20 years old. When I was swimming, about twice a day normally, and when I was 8 years old, my parents took me out of state to like all over the country. We went to California, Tennessee, Maryland, South Dakota, Nebraska, Florida, And as an eight-year-old, I became a Colorado state champion. That was pretty cool as an eight-year-old. I don't know that I really knew what that meant, but the sport required an incredible amount of commitment, not just from me as a kid, but also from my parents, who dedicated so much of their time to swim practices and swim meets. And now that I'm an adult, I understand what a huge commitment that was. The Northglenn swim team was an enormous swimming program, as Rosie said, and it was a big part of this community. Both boys and girls competed, and many drove from nearby towns to be on this particular swim team. My mom wrote articles every week in the Northglenn Sentinel, covering our swim meets in detail and always with pictures. The Northglenn Auditorium was the largest and only second to the Air Force Academy pool. It was an incredible facility. It had 10 lanes, a big diving area with a viewing deck below, complete with the stands for the parents and the fans, and then also a large records board, as you saw in the ROTC video. That was huge. I am so grateful for the resources that Northglenn afforded me and so many others, with such a unique opportunity and the strong community that supported our entire team. We gained a lifetime appreciation for power of community, and we developed a fierce competitive nature. Both of those attributes have served me and helped me in my entire life so far. As a kid, I had an idea of what I maybe wanted to do, but I really didn't have a clear path of what I really wanted to do. I knew what activities I enjoyed, but what I couldn't see was how my interests might turn into long-term goals or plans. But thank goodness my parents did, because they were always a few steps ahead of me, providing that much-needed direction. Believe it or not, without my mom and dad nudging me along, I would never have joined ROTC in college. I wasn't familiar with the military or ROTC, and we didn't have junior ROTC in high school at the time. So I'm really glad to see that we now have a program. But I could become a helicopter pilot or a doctor in the Army, and I thought that was pretty cool. I eventually grew to find my place in the ROTC program, and I certainly love our military and our Army now, and I have enjoyed all my 32 years of service. But as a teenager, I didn't quite have things figured out yet. I knew I loved swimming, but I couldn't see how to translate that into a job. At 16, I studied and practiced to earn my private pilot's license in single-engine airplanes, but as a high school student, I didn't think it was possible, for whatever reason, that I could be an airline pilot one day. It just seemed unattainable or impossible. How could I possibly get there? I also studied pre-med as a major in college. My athleticism and Army ROTC in college was really the catalyst that propelled me to have two choices of either becoming a doctor or a pilot. But without my parents, my high school teachers, and my swim coach, I would have never reached that conclusion on my own. My point is that if you don't know where you're going, it will be hard to get there. There are so many opportunities out there in our country for military service, for public service, for national service, and our teachers, coaches, and parents are our guides to those opportunities. And those opportunities are fleeting. And if you're not ready to reach and grab them in high school, there's a good chance they won't come around again and they'll just pass you by. As children, we are often asked by grown-ups, what do you want to be when you grow up? That at some point, when you're a middle schooler or a high schooler, maybe we aren't asked, or they aren't asked, that particular question as much. And there's more of a focus on achievements of the present. Schoolwork, sports, friends, the after-school job. As we grow from children to adolescents, do we forget how strong our dreams are? Or do we see how difficult it is to achieve our dream, and maybe think that it's too hard? I think that's where parents, teachers, and coaches are so important to show the path to opportunities for our high schoolers. Very few young people are decided about their future at a young age, and only about 5%, if even that, are really self-starters that don't need any prompting or inspiration. And so my message to you tonight is this: we must help our youth find their dream and then connect a pathway to that dream. Our young people really need the support of their community, like the community that was there for me as well. I'm astounded when I look back now and realize the sacrifices that my parents and all the parents on the swim team made. I am also so grateful to my swim coaches, Coach Kitamira and Ken Abuna, and my biochemistry teacher, Mr. Lemieux. They not only provided the support and inspiration for me to excel in the pool and at school, they also taught me determination and commitment, which are very valuable attributes. To the adults in the room tonight, you are more than just supervisors of our youth, as you know. You are the mentors and the advisors. You are sources of inspiration, and we need to encourage and foster more the big dreams of children at a young age and continue to encourage that through the teenage years. Present them opportunities, open their minds and eyes to wider possibilities, offer them direction, provide the support structure and a pathway to actually achieve those dreams. I mentioned earlier that opportunities are fleeting. Let me give you a few examples of unique opportunities that relate to service, since it's a field I know well. From a Service Academy appointment, to an ROTC scholarship, to enlistment in the military. Military service builds skill sets that will benefit you throughout your life. Leadership, strength of character, integrity, responsibility. A newly commissioned lieutenant is responsible for more people and equipment than most of their fellow college graduates. On average, a platoon leader in the Army is in charge of 40 soldiers and at least $30 million worth of equipment. That's a lot of responsibility to have at 22 years old. The Army also has new and exciting fields opening up to both men and women. Women can now serve in all branches of the Army, to include infantry and armor. And as our Army evolves for the future, exciting high-tech fields like cyber, space, network communications, not to mention the expanding fields of aviation, armor, air defense, medical doctors, dentists, veterinarians, all have great opportunities for sharp, motivated applicants. But you can serve your country in a myriad of ways, not just through military service. The Peace Corps program offers the opportunity to spend 2 years in a foreign country working with a community on local projects. Time spent employed by the national parks preserves our history and the majestic beauty of our landscape. AmeriCorps allows you to give back to our country by working at nonprofits, schools, or public agencies. Through the City Year program, you improve education in America's underprivileged communities. And Citizen Corps, coordinated by FEMA, enlists your help to aid first responders with natural and man-made disaster response. From the military, to civilian service, these opportunities will give you a sense of purpose and the satisfaction of contributing to something larger than yourself. And all these organizations are now looking for bright leaders that our Northglenn community is known for. For me, the military gave me the direction I needed, and serving my country is truly the work that I love. From my time as a platoon leader, my very first job in the Army, to serving as acting commanding general of U.S. Army Forces Command, I have found my life's work very satisfying. I've always felt that I've made a positive difference by providing my soldiers with the best leadership possible, to ensuring our Army is best postured for success in the future. My career in the Army began on a typical path from second lieutenant to major. My first assignment after flight school was to Korea, and the typical one-year assignment turned into 4 years there. But my husband Jim was stationed there too, and our daughter Lauren was born there. We were subsequently stationed at Fort Hood, Texas, then Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, and Fort Campbell, Kentucky. As I look back though, I don't think that I was a very good second lieutenant or first lieutenant. But when I married my husband, who was a couple years ahead of me in the Army, he really coached and mentored me in what it was to be a good leader. Without his counsel, I may not have made it past captain. But I was very motivated to do my very best. I'm very competitive, gained from all that competitive swimming. And as I've mentioned, so that was already in my DNA. not to lose. Then as a major, I was selected to be the vice president's military aide. So that was a very unique experience because the vice president at the time was running for president. It was an extremely busy schedule. We traveled the equivalent of 13 times around the world in that position. I went on to become the first female combat helicopter battalion commander in the Army, a position I held while deployed to Iraq in 2003. My husband was also a battalion commander at the time, and he was over there with me. So I think we were the first married couple of battalion commanders in combat at the time. So as a colonel, I had the honor of commanding Fort Myer, Virginia, and Fort McNair, Washington, D.C. as the 100th commander, and then served on Capitol Hill as the Army's liaison officer to the United States Senate. Next, as a general officer, I was selected to be the first female deputy commanding general of a combat armored division and deputy commanding general for Forces Command. And now I am the acting commander for Forces Command. And I never imagined any of this was even possible. Throughout my career in the Army, I've been afforded some unique opportunities that really opened the door for me. But it has never been about what has been presented to me. I've worked hard in every position that I have served in. Nothing was handed to me, and I haven't just been lucky. I have earned my place through hard work and learning from failures. What I haven't told you is that the first time I tried out for the swim team as a young child, I didn't make the team. What would have happened if I had stopped swimming then? And I was faced with a short setback. I didn't stop, though. Instead, I worked hard all year to train and prepare myself for the next tryout with the Northglenn swim team. The advice I would give all of you in this audience that many of you already know: be absolutely competent and confident in your profession. Be consistent in your performance and be committed. Take responsibility for your own shortcomings and overcome them. Concentrate on improving your weaknesses and maintaining your strengths. You own your success. I'm looking at the ROTC cadets out there and all the other kids in here. It is up to you to ensure you have earned the credentials and possess the right attributes for the extraordinary opportunities that may come your way. But it all begins with a dream, a vision of what you want and where you want to go. Find that dream and then work hard in pursuit of that dream. There are many thousands of opportunities out there, service to the nation being one of those avenues, but you won't arrive anywhere if you haven't thought about where you might want to go. And it's the teachers, parents, coaches, employers, and public figures of our city that provide that support. Structure, guidance, and a deliberate path. That makes those dreams happen. They play a very important role in the development of our future leaders. To the supportive community of Northglenn, I personally want to thank you for building the safe and nurturing environment that allows Northglenn youth to grow. And they need you to inspire them and dream alongside them. Thank you so much for the tremendous opportunity to come back to my hometown and share with all of you tonight. You have made me feel most welcome. I look forward to the onstage interview and to talking to all of you after the event. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Laura. Am I too old to join the Army? You inspired me. You know, we seldom have an opportunity like this to hear about from someone who we respect and someone, one of our own, about the military and the future that you can have in the military. I just want to thank you again for coming, for starters. I think it's a real treat for us. Now we have an unprecedented opportunity for a Northglenn High School senior, Gabriella Gomez, to interview Lieutenant General Richardson. Coincidentally, she mimics Laura's early years. She's not only a swimmer, but she's also a member of the ROTC at Northglenn High School. I'd like to welcome Nighthawk Unit Delta Flight Cadet Gabriella Gomez to the stage.
I'm thinking of doing ROTC in college. Can you explain to me what ROTC is like?
So ROTC in college is, it is, I had a great time in ROTC in college, and it teaches you about the service, you know, that you're applying for and that you're in ROTC for, but it also teaches you about the other services. And I felt that it was a nice, you know, you didn't feel like you were in the service. You know, you had ROTC once a week, you had lab in the afternoon, you know, and you had class as well, but it taught you a lot about leadership, it taught you a lot about the service, and the cadre was just, that's really what makes the experience, is the cadre of the ROTC program. And Sergeant Major Mike Padilla, what a wonderful American hero he is. And Rosie got that quote for him, and I'm gonna ask her for his phone number so I can call him, because I have lost touch with him. But the mentoring, the coaching, and the advising, because you know your first 2 years of ROTC, you don't necessarily have to be on scholarship or anything like that, but it's really, you know, you can try it out and see if you like it. But quite honestly, the opportunities that you learn about that you can do in the program, just like what I showed you, just my career, I could have never picked or selected or even thought of doing those things in the Army, right? And so just amazing opportunities. But there are amazing opportunities in all of our services. All those things that I did, you can do those in any of the service.
I can't wait. As more women enter STEM careers and doors open for us in military programs, we find ourselves in primarily male-dominated playing fields. In those circumstances, it's sometimes easy to question your abilities and maybe even have self-doubts. How do you overcome these moments?
You don't think about it.
Okay, fair enough. In your role as...
I'm going to expound a little bit. So seriously, you should not think about that, because if you're good at what you do, so that's what I always tell young people, is don't try to fit in when you're trying out for whatever you're doing, a new job, you're in the service, you know, don't try to fit in with the group, because if you try to push fitting in, then that is not, that normally doesn't work out, right? So what I've always told young people is just be competent at what your job is. So when you're new, you're not going to be very competent, right? And so work your way into that. Learn all you can. Be a fast learner, because for in the military, you know, we're always moving and that kind of thing. I think really we, anywhere from 5 to 10% per month in our units in the service, in the Army anyway, we have people that are coming in and are departing to go to their next assignment. And so you always have new people. You won't be new for very long, right? And so I always tell people, take that opportunity to learn your job as best that you can. And then just by you being good and competent, then you'll be able to fit in. When I first went into the military and I went to, at the time it was called Officer Basic School, I wasn't really a runner, so I was a swimmer. And being a runner and being good at running is not the same. You can be a good swimmer and be a crappy runner. And so I found out that I was a crappy runner.
I was like, gosh, I work out all the time, and now I'm having a hard time running 2 miles, which is what you have to do for your physical fitness test. And so I started running as well. But prior to probably about 6 months before I actually went to go to Fort Rucker for my officer basic course, I started running quite a bit. And I would get up to I started doing 5 miles a day, just because I knew I needed to be in good shape and I needed to be a good runner. Unfortunately, swimming wasn't part of the deal when I went to officer basic course. Well, then when I got there, I could run faster than there were only 5 out of maybe 40 males that could beat me at running. So I was pretty fast. And then of course I could do really good in push-ups because I was a butterfly, right? I could do push-ups all day long. And so, I mean, it was actually pretty easy. And so that helped me fit in. I didn't have to try to push, trying to make friends because I was either as good or better than them in some of the things. So that would be my advice.
Thank you. In your role as a military advisor to Vice President Al Gore, and today in briefing Army leaders with information from FORSCOM, I'm sure there are times you've had to share an unpopular opinion based on your research. How do you approach these conversations diplomatically? What would you say is the key to reaching common ground with a superior?
Say yes, sir, or yes, ma'am. So I think it's important that you have to have situational awareness of your surroundings. And so I'm in a lot of meetings in my current job with our Secretary of the Army and our Chief of Staff of the Army. So the two head leaders, our civilian leader and our uniformed leader of the Army, at least 3 or 4 times a day in different meetings. And so part of what I talked about before is you got to build a respect that they respect you for what you're doing in your position. And then also, you got to speak the truth too, but you might not want to do it in a large forum, right? Or you might want to wait to do a smaller forum or ask to speak to one of them after the meeting or something like that. Or, it all depends on what the situation calls for, but I would say you need to have situational awareness. And you can't just blurt things out and depending on what kind of an environment you're in. But, when we're talking about we take care of America's sons and daughters in the military, and normally the job that we do means lives, and so you're empowered to speak the truth. But I would just say, there are better ways to do it than others, and you got to be situationally aware when you're doing that. Does that all make sense?
Yes. Thank you. As being a great leader, being in a position to assess people competing for promotion and evaluate someone on their career path, what do you look for in a great leader?
I think what I look for in a great leader is the initiative, a good attitude, being positive. But initiative is really, really important because there's a lot of things that we do, even at my level. I'm very much an action officer, like the rest of our folks that are on our staff at the Forces Command. And I watched my previous boss, his name is General Abe Abrams. The Abrams tank is named after his father. And so I watched him, and I thought he had at least 4 battery packs hooked up in his back, because he was just he was phenomenal. He'd be in meetings giving direction and guidance to commanders, corps commanders, division commanders, and then the next minute he's in his office and he's either on the phone or he's on the email working the Army leaders or the Army staff. So he was very much an action officer too. And so I think it's important that you can always learn from people you work with. I've always learned quite a few things from the people you work with and you work around. But I think that, quite honestly, you look for that being positive and wanting to get things done is what I look for.
So many high school students excel at sports and struggle in school. The world sometimes makes you feel like if you don't excel in academics, you won't excel in life. What is your advice for those kinds of students?
Well, I would say that I wish I would have studied harder.
We had kind of the same high school career.
And I realized that when I got into the Army and that sort of thing, I didn't feel like I was as smart as I could be. But struggle isn't bad, right? And so the thing is that you know what your shortcomings are, or what your weaknesses are, and that you work and you try to achieve and get better at the shortcomings. So if you're not as good in school and you know that, then, you know, it's very easy to figure out what you need to do better in school, right? So I would say that while I think when I was growing up, being good at sports was, it was okay to do that, you know, and not be very good at school. But I quickly found out, though, when I got out in the world that I wish I would have studied harder when I was coming up. So my advice to the young people here is try whatever you're not very good at, just put more effort towards it, because struggle is not bad. And as I said, there are many times that you won't make, you won't achieve what you want to achieve or you're trying to achieve the first time. And so you gotta try again.
Okay. Do you know that you're a rock star and so many serving and civilian to so many civilian and serving women?
No.
Well, coming from me, I would say so.
Well, I'm really, like I said, I was so proud to come speak at the JRTC ball. I've learned in my time in the Army and working up at our leadership level how important junior ROTC programs are around our country as well as ROTC. And to be honest with you, the United States senators and the U.S. congressmen watch those programs very, very closely. In fact, during my time as the legislative liaison for the Army, I did that for 3 years, there were members that called all the time over to our Secretary of the Army wanting more programs in their cities because of how good that program was. And so, but anyway, I'm very proud of Gabby. She's pretty amazing.
Thank you. I just wanted to say thank you for this opportunity and serving, and I hope we stay in touch later down the road.
We will. Thank you.
One more time, and thanking Laura for sharing her life lessons with us tonight and really her time for even being here with us this evening. So I would also like to thank my co-presenters this evening, Gabriella Gomez and Rosie Garner, for helping out. And thank you most of all for attending the program. I know that I'm energized and inspired by the lessons that she's taught us this evening. And as we close out the evening, Laura's going to exit out the back, and she is going to set up for a photo op. And when we leave, we can all go out and chat with her and have our photos taken with her. So once again, thank you for attending Women's History in the Making. and helping celebrate Northglenn's 50th anniversary. Thank you and have a great evening.